Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thanks to IMA and the members. So today I will talk about the recent advances in adult cardiac surgery. I'm mainly concentrating on minimally invasive cardiac surgery. Coronary artery bypass graft surgery, starting from the 1970s when it started, it was predominantly the standard of treatment for coronary artery disease. But now, as you know, it's less than 50% or just about there. So initially, at least even up to a decade ago, patients having proximal LAD stenosis and left main stem stenosis were treated with surgery. But now, as you can see, this is the most recent guidelines, European as well as American, published few months ago. There is a significant number of our class 1A indication for single or two vessel disease with proximal LAD stenosis is PCI as equal to surgery. Also, patients with the left main stem disease, as you can see, is class 1A indication for both surgery and stenting. So these are the only factors now favoring CABG in multivessel disease patients with diabetes, which forms a significant population of our patients. Patients with multivessel disease with reduced left ventricular function less than 35%, and patients with Syntax score more than 22. Syntax score is a scoring system based on anatomy of the lesions on the coronary arteries. So more than 22 is an indication for surgery. And patients who have recurrent restenosis of stents, as well as who cannot tolerate dual antiplatelet therapy. So the main reason for surgery is the internal mammary artery conduits. Luckily we have two and we tend to use two whenever possible. And in diabetics still, this stands as a gold standard. This is about the, from the recent guidelines as well, on conduits that could be used. So class 1A indication used to is to use LIMA, left internal mammary artery to LAD in almost all patients. It is not ethical to not use LAD or LIMA to LAD unless there is a definitive contraindication in the patient. And bilateral internal mammary artery in patients who are less than 70 years should be considered. In my practice, we do it on all patients below 60 because our patients are physiologically 10 years older. But we tend to use it up to 70 years of age. Radial artery only in patients who have significant stenosis, gastroepiploric not anymore. And total arterial revascularization in patients who have long life expectancy. So patients under 50 years of age, we tend to use almost all arteries. So this is the evidence behind use of bilateral internal mammary artery use from Cleveland Clinic, published in the early 2000. They looked at over 6,000 patients over a 10 years period, and they showed both survival advantage as well as reduced risk of restenosis. A significant difference between single and bilateral mammary artery use. Still, it's very, the use of bilateral mammary is very less. In our country, there was a survey performed about 2.5 to 3 years ago. Only 3% surgeons are using it. Why this possibly are the reasons? Age, technical acquaintance, and time constraints play a major role in this. But it's like anything else, when you do it routinely, these two factors don't play a major role anymore. And sternal wound infection was a problem in the early phase, but now we skeletonize the one or the two mammary arteries. By skeletonization, I mean we just take the artery on its own without any surrounding tissues. That reduces the wound infection rate significantly. So that's the right internal mammary artery taken on its own. This is the left with some tissue. So this doesn't have any increased risk of wound infection. The other major advantage is when we use two mammary arteries, there is hardly any cut in the leg. Just for the right side, we take one piece of vein with two tiny cuts, being a minimally invasive surgeon. When the patients don't see a big cut in the leg, they start walking straight away. It's very easy to make them walk day one. Patients with big cuts, they tend not to put their feet down. So this reduces risk of wound infection and makes them get home early. Our patients, even with open surgery, tend to go home day five. Coming to minimally invasive cardiac surgery now, almost all adult surgeries, valve surgeries and CABGs can be performed through this approach. But still, there is only 70% of patient population that we can perform this. I'll tell you which 30 may not be suitable. As we go through the talk, I think you will be able to get it clear. The initial definition for minimally invasive surgery, when it started 20 years ago, was anything that avoids full sternotomy. But not anymore. Now we make it smaller cuts with the help of either thoracoscope or Da Vinci robotic system. So it's a small cut, about 5 centimeters, along right or left side of the chest, aided by one of these instruments. It's still a rare specialty, mainly due to lack of training, but now a few of our centers in the country have started training younger surgeons, and also the time constraint that we have put through to when we stop the heart and valve surgeries, or we have to work against a beating, moving target in CABG surgeries. But still patients demand, and mainly visualization, like thoracoscope or Da Vinci robotic system, has helped us move and progress in this specialty. So that's a typical CABG on the left side of the chest, about 5 centimeters. This is using thoracoscope, so the camera port for the thoracoscope. If it's a robotic system, you won't use one down below. And that's at the end of the procedure. So the surgery for a single vessel probably takes about 2 hours. For 2 or 3 vessels, takes 4 to 5 hours. In multi-vessel disease, it takes maybe half an hour or 1 hour extra in theater. But they go home day 3 and get back to normal living within 2 weeks. So commonly, single two vessels we tackle, we don't open chest anymore. Unless they have more diffuse disease where you have to put more grafts. And this is what I've already said, reduces wound infection risk and significantly transfusion and related risks. Now we are able to combine this for multi-vessel disease as well with hybrid revascularization. We routinely perform this in our center in Apollo here. So for triple vessel disease, patients who require Lima LID or bilateral mammary to the left side and who may need 2 or maximum 3 stents, apart from this, we subject them to 2, or we discuss with them the hybrid approach. If they need more than 2 or 3 stents, we tend not to do this and we do the open procedures. So this is combining the advantage of mammary artery use, the newer stents which have longer patency rates. We are trying to get best of both worlds for treatment of these patients. So this is not a new procedure. It was tried in the early or mid-90s when minimally invasive surgery started. But unfortunately, we didn't have patients or surgeons were in the learning curve, as well as we didn't have as good stents as now the fourth generation stents. Hence, it was given up with poor results. But now we are able to give a better result with surgeons moving off the learning curve and with better stents as well. The major, we do a two-stage approach. The surgeons that we operate on day 0, day 2, they usually have the stents, and then day 4, they go home. Now, the advantages are mainly by doing this approach, we avoid antiplatelet-related bleeding issues with surgery. And following this, the cardiologist can perform even complex stenting to the other 1 or 2 vessels, circ or right, because they have a protected Lima to LAD which is flowing. And also, we check the patency of Lima to LAD in all these patients. That gives reassurance to us, cardiologists, and the patients. The only disadvantage being cost. It's slightly more expensive, not a lot. So that's, I'll show a couple of angiograms. This is the patient who had complete occlusion of the LAD, chronic total occlusion, nothing flowing there, and significant disease. It's a left main equivalent of the circumflex. So this is after the stent, good circumflex flow. And we also check the Lima flow, which goes all the way back. This is the Lima flowing into the LAD both ways. This is another patient having bilateral internal mammary artery, that is the Lima, and the Lima is a Y graft to the circumference. You can see there's good flow in both arteries. This patient had stent to the right. This is another patient. So in 2014 circulation, there was a review about hybrid revascularization. It's a very new technique, started about 5 years ago, and it's now increasingly practiced in the Western world. In our country, it's still yet to come. So the best, mainly there is advantage in younger patients, both economic benefits, because they are able to get back to work yearly and reduces hospitalization, thus a financial benefit overall as well. But it should be performed in centers where the trained surgeons in minimally invasive cardiac surgery, we with good integration between cardiologists and surgeons. All our patients, when we think either the cardiologist or me, and we think they are suitable for hybrid, we sit together with the patient, have a discussion, and then plan procedure. We have also started doing it through a robotic procedure. We did the first surgery about a month ago for hybrid. So it is all teamwork. My trainer came to set this up for us. And we work together as a team. For all minimal invasive procedures, we have to have a teamwork. Our anesthetist, cardiologist, and the scrub team as well. Main advantages of robotic surgery, yes, it is slightly more expensive, but it gives huge benefit. Even with thoracoscope mammary harvest, there is a little bit of rib spreading more than the others, but in this there is no rib spreading at all, hardly any pain to the patient, and it also gives us the 360 degree extended arms, there are four arms, so it reduces any risk of tremors and good in taking down both mammary arteries quickly. Disadvantage, other thing about, apart from cost, is learning curve. There is a long learning curve, but once you are through, it's good for the patients. So we have done about 50 cases now since the last 16 months, and we are doing it for predominantly two groups of patients. Low, in our country, unfortunately, a lot of our patients are under 60, the yearning population. So for them, getting back to work is very very much required or efficient in that manner. So paying that extra 75,000 to 1 lakh is actually going to be cost benefit for them because they get back to work within 2 weeks, unlike 3 months. And the other group is the high risk group. We do them in a lot of octogenarians as well. So more than 75, 80, we operate a lot of them. So we do the knee myelady and then the other one or two vessels are stented. So this is significant. We had about 12 patients in this group. Even patients with chronic kidney disease, we are able to offer this because now our cardiologists are able to perform stents with 5 to 6 ml dye using ultrasound guided stenting. So, and poor LV functions. One patient had was under remission following leukemia. We performed one of them as well. Now coming to aortic valve replacements. The indications are very much similar. There are two approaches. One, the upper hemisternotomy up to the third space, or through a right second or third intercostal space. Indications, as I said, are very much similar. That's a J incision in the upper hemisternotomy. The incision is very small. Once we get used to it, it's no different. But it's a standard bypass through the same aorta and the right artery. So there's no added risks to the patient. The upper incision is about 6 centimeters. Again, the patients get back to normal activity within a month. So this is the other side, as I said, in the right, the second or third intercostal space. But not every patient may be suitable to this. We should have an aorta specifically slightly on the right side and with less distance from the sternal angle. So about 30% patients will be suitable to that. This was our early findings we presented about 10 years ago. We showed minimally invasive aortic valve replacement was significantly beneficial in reducing hospital stay, reduced risk of transfusion, and early return to normal activity. Now, as we all know, TAVI is taking up. Now, the recent PARTNER 3 trial has shown it is superior even in low-risk patients. So in the next 10 years, I would see this as primary PCR. Like stents, predominantly it will be a 50-50 between surgery and this. Currently it's very expensive, but soon it will come down on the price. So this is something which we do together as a heart team between surgeons and the cardiologists. It's going to be future for aortic valve replacements, like stents are for coronary artery disease. A mitral valve repair or replacement, we tend to use thoracoscope in our center. It can be either aided by thoracoscope or Da Vinci robotic system. I trained under Dr. Hugo Vanneman, who was one of the pioneers in designing these techniques. These were the four people who standardized the procedure. Among them was Hugo Vanneman in Belgium. So the current standard approach is through a right anterior thoracotomy, 5 or 6 centimeters, in the fourth or fifth intercostal space, using one of these instruments. Patient selection is the key. Initially, we used to avoid oversized and undersized patients, but these in our country, a lot of the patients are undersized. below 50 kilograms. In those patients, we offer now these procedures, but in patients under 50 years of age, we tend to look at the peripheral vessels for cannulation through a normal CT aortogram, non-contrast CT. If it's more than 6 millimeters, then we still go ahead and do it through this approach. Oversized patients significantly benefit. More than 100 kilos patients, they have huge benefit by going through the minimally invasive approach as opposed to open procedure. Again, it's a team approach. We see the patients together with the cardiologist and anesthetist. That's how we position, right side up, and femoral cannulation for cardiopulmonary bypass. So this is the incision with two ports, the top one being camera port and the lower one CO2 and suction port. So that's what we see inside of the pericardium. And that's the valve. Everybody can see what the surgeon is doing. It's foolproof and good to train younger surgeons. So this was a valve replacement procedure with the bioprosthesis. That's the valve in place. That's at the end of the procedure. So about 5 to 6 centimeters, the two ports are used for the drains. And that's in 2 weeks' time. Patients hardly know what's happened and they get back to work very early. So especially for repairs, it's extremely good because they get the normal life expectancy if it's done and the early phase of repair before there is any cardiac dilatations or patients going to AF. This was a P2 prolapse, posterior mitral prolapse. So with repair using neocortic. So repair is best whenever possible. Even in rheumatics, we tend to attempt repair if the pathology is predominantly revegetation. It's predominantly stenosis, it's very difficult to repair, except in very experienced hands, one or two in the world, including Dr. Sampath Kumar in AIIMS, Delhi. But all other patients with mitral valve regurgitation pathology could be attempted repair. For rheumatics, we tend to open and do because we are still in our learning curve. But degenerative, 99% we are able to repair through the minimally invasive approach. Main reasons being are it maintains the left ventricle integrity. We're repairing the valve, which gives good long-term results, and we can avoid anticoagulation in the young, especially female population in our country, who are in the reproductive age group. This was our findings, which were published about 2-3 years ago in the SMICS, Society of Minimally Invasive Cardiac Surgery, Boston. We showed the mortality, morbidity risks were under 1% in over 1,200 patients. Various other procedures that are required in the right heart can be performed through the same approach. Atrial septal defects and atrial septal defects, we don't open the heart chest anymore, and also tumors in the chest. This was a patient who had tricuspid repair, awaiting transplant. We did 3 years ago. He did extremely well, who would have had a lot of bleeding otherwise. So finally, aortic surgery. A lot of type B dissections are repaired through endovascular now. And now we are able to perform even aneurysms of the arch by debranching and then performing them. So as from the IRAD, IRAD International Registry of Aortic Dissections, yearly complications are significantly reduced, stroke, paraplegia. This is one very interesting case with a large aneurysm in the arch, descending and lower part of the aorta. We debranch the head and neck vessels in a previously bypass patient with patent grafts. So he did extremely well, he is almost more than 2.5 years. So the major advantages with minimally invasive surgery are reduced tissue infection, reduced transfusion and related risk, yearly return to normal activity, short hospital stay. 2 slides about transplant. I just want to say transplant is being practiced well with minimal morbidity and mortality. So just the 2 slides to show that it's a multidisciplinary approach and patient selection is key. Heart failure patients, which we have plenty of them, which are not even seen by many cardiologists yet, I think we should get them to the cardiologist and to surgeons as a team to decide whether most of them are suitable or not. Now our government is providing a facility to operate on these patients. They provide funds in low socioeconomic group as well. Common indications are dilated cardiomyopathy and ischemic cardiomyopathy. Congenital heart disease patients actually do very well. A typical patient who would benefit extremely well would be before multi-organ failure sets in, a patient who is between 35 to 55 years of age.
and that's the survival curve. As you can see, congenital heart disease patients are almost 50% are alive at 20 years. In the 5 years mortality is only 20%, 80% are alive, and 10 years survival is about 50%. So to summarize, almost 70% of adult cardiac procedures can be done through minimal invasive approach. Still, open sternotomy cannot be avoided in the other 30%, like complex anatomy patients, some complex redo cases and transplant procedures. Arterial revascularization, bilateral mammary artery use whenever possible in young patients and diabetics, and valve repair whenever possible in especially mitrals, if not the aortics. Thank you.
You said our patients are 10 years physiologically
older.
What do you mean by that?
So when we see our patients, I've worked there for about 20 years. When we see here our patients in the age of 60, physiologically the tissue fragility is all a little more. But this doesn't fit into the upper socioeconomic group. So there's a variation in that. So that's one reason we are actually devising an Indian heart score now. Because our Euroscore doesn't fit into our patients. We have actually included diabetic status and nutritional status, including the other factors in Euroscore, to form a Euroscore with the Indian society, which it should be out, then we could fit in where we stand. But we noticed the Euroscore of 3 is actually Indian score of 6 for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.